So this is part three of our look at La Bataille. And we're finally going to get past some of the building block fundamentals. Scale and morale are just sort of like integral parts of the whole system all throughout. Now we're going to start getting down into the pieces and parts of each aspect of the game. And we're going to move into command and control. Now, command and control is a fairly familiar concept to wargamers. Essentially, we have this omniscient view of the field where we can see everything, know where everything is. We can measure out in time and space exactly how long it will take to do something. And that just kind of leaves a bad taste in our mouth because it feels like we know too much and can control too much. So games introduce little mechanics to put a limit on us. This is the first time we're going to see an extreme difference between the Premier rules and the 5th edition rules. They go about solving this particular dilemma in very, very different fashions. And one or the both may not appeal at all to some or all players. We're going to look at them. I think we can at least agree that they're both trying to achieve a very similar effect, just by very different means. So we'll start with the Premier rules. Command and control in the Premier rules is largely represented by timed moves. That's it. Well, maybe not completely, because we have to investigate what that really means. Each side, each army, each nationality is given a certain amount of time to move their forces each turn. And that is strictly movement of forces during the actual movement phase. Any kind of reaction or even cavalry charging operations are considered outside of that timed boundary. Now, roughly what that allotment of time really means is that's how much time the designers feel is necessary to move a single, like, larger organization, larger formation in the game. So that might be an infantry corps for the French, or a wing for the, you know, the opponents. Just some relatively large amount of troops can be maneuvered in the time allotted. So it kind of implies that there will be simultaneous movement of formations, which kind of plays into the idea of team play, group play, multiple players moving forces at the same time for a side. So again, the amount of time allotted varies by nationality. That kind of reflects the different approach and value given to maybe staff work and the quality of officers, doctrines, things of that nature. Usually the French have the most amount of time. They're kind of seen as having the best organization to their forces. And other nationalities can have, you know, different times based on what historically the designer thought they were capable of. So are the actual mechanics for command and control of this style? Well, get a timer. When your turn starts, start the timer. Then, start to move your forces. Remember, the clock is ticking. You think this guy needs to move over here? Move him to whatever the movement rules permit. We've got Napoleon back here, the leader of the 3rd Corps right there. All the units of the 8th Division right here. I didn't want to set up every single unit, so over here I've got another divisional leader. Another divisional leader parade around here. I can move all of them anywhere I want, as long as I stay within the rules of movement. The leadership has really no bearing on this. It's only a time factor. So I keep moving until one of two things happens. I finish moving my forces, or the timer finally elapses. The timer elapses. That's it. Pencils down. No more movement. Put your head on your desk and wait for the others. So where's the control in this? Well, if you're playing team play, and I have the third corps and you have the fourth corps and someone else has the cavalry, well, we need to kind of coordinate with each other to make sure our attacks go in the way we want. Some team play don't allow any conversation between players, except through some mechanism of exchanging dispatches. You can do that if you want. But there's another aspect. If I move my forces in any way I want, I can make mistakes, especially with the time limit. I can expose someone in a way that makes it very dangerous to my forces. You know, if you want to move cavalry on some wide flanking maneuver, go ahead and do that. You've just sort of diluted your own, you know, avenues of attack. If you want to expose infantry, go ahead, because those flanks will be rolled up pretty quickly by the opponent. So there's an aspect of learning the interactions of the forces that really plays into controlling you, the player, rather than a mechanic in the game. There's one inescapable conclusion that we can draw from this, and that is leaders are for fighting. Leaders have all manner of qualities that they bring to the field, and in Premier rules, you want those leaders using those qualities in the thick of the fight, because there's really no benefit to keeping them back, because you're not protecting them for any particular reason. So get the marshal out there. Let's look at his qualities. He has four. Let's zoom in there. He's capable of providing modifiers of 4 and 6 in melee combat. He can affect cavalry, artillery, morale. So why not put Marshal Ney out in the front? Doesn't matter if he gets killed, just so long as he's effectively, you know, orchestrating the fight right in the front. But that doesn't necessarily mean that you want all leaders in the front, because those with really good morale modifiers can be kept in the back, rallying troops. They can chase a battalion into the rear areas, use their morale modifier to rally them and get them back into the fight. It's perfectly fine to move leaders around like that. Now, the 5th edition rules stand in stark contrast to that. They have a very specific command and control structure, and it's based on the organizational hierarchies of the different armies involved. So a side's forces would be divided into an army or armies, especially in the case of Lützen here. Within the army, there's a breakdown of a corps or a wing or a column or a line, some sort of a larger formation. And each of those can then break down into a division or a brigade. And then down at the lowest level is usually a battalion or a regiment or a company. And it's that relationship of hierarchy is kind of the foundation of the 5th edition command and control rules. And most often these hierarchies are presented in the organizational displays with a given title, but I'm just going to cheat a little bit and use a play aid that was created for the game Blitzen here. So we see here that Napoleon is the overall leader of the army. Underneath him we have the Guard, Army d'Elbe, led by Eugene, and Army de Maine, led by Soult. So those are three large organizations underneath Napoleon. Underneath each corps, each army, we have corps. 11th Corps, Reserve Cavalry Corps. Under the Soult, we have the 3rd Corps, the 4th Corps, and the 6th Corps here. So each of these organizational units comprise part of the command structure. Napoleon to Eugene, Eugene to MacDonald, MacDonald to each of his division commanders, and then each of these divisions has units, combat units, underneath them that then are commanded by that division commander. So that chain of command is observed in the command and control rules. So the second aspect are command points. Command points are assigned to different high-level entities that exist in the organizational structure. Just keeping with the French here, and you kind of see I'm already giving away here with this play aid. Napoleon generates a command point because he's the overall commander. We see the guard generates a command point. This play aid is, you know, very convenient. It lays out the command points on the table here. But basically what we're seeing here is Napoleon, an army commander, each of the army commanders, anything representing a corps generates a command point. So just in this structure right here, we can see that the French have a lot of command capability just by the nature of the organization of their army. And taking a look at the coalition for this particular battle, it's a little bit different. We have an army leader here. They're divided into lines along the top here. And then the lines are divided into wings. So here we have the first line commanded by General Blücher. He has three brigades, and each brigade has, you know, one or more battalions associated with it. The second line for York has several brigades and then a wing. And then the reserve line has two wings. So it's like they separated their wings among the second and reserve line. And then looking at the Army Reserve, they have a left and a right wing. So you can see this is kind of a Frankenstein's monster construction of the Army organizational hierarchy. So they have kind of fewer command points at their discretion or disposal. Each of the line generates one. The army leader generates one. But because the Tsar is here and he's a, you know, meddling fellow, that kind of disrupts their command structure a little bit. They can see it's the same hierarchical organization, regardless of the army. So what are these command point things? In general, an army leader and any corps leader in a particular side generates a command point. Think of it as a unit of command that can be used to orchestrate activities on the field for that side. So the French here, and the command points are only available when those forces are on the board. So sometimes if you have a meeting engagement or reinforcements arriving, those command points don't come into play until those forces arrive. Additionally, light cavalry leaders are able to roll for initiative to see if they can generate a command point of their own, essentially for their own use. Because command points are basically usable across the army. Even though a command point is generated by the 11th Corps here, you could very well use it to take action with the 3rd Corps if you wanted to. Sometimes games limit that usage, but in general, it's more like all the quarters go into the hat and you can use them for whatever purpose you want. But light cavalry, if they do roll for initiative, they can only activate themselves with that command point. So now that you have these command points, what do you do with them? Well, you use them to effectively order some forces to do something. And really that boils down to giving the formation the ability to move, you know, actively, purposefully, during a single turn. So you can think of them as the currency. Command points are the currency, and movement is the product that you want to buy. So the effect is that even though you may have a huge army, if you only have a little bit of command points available, you will be limited to moving only that portion of the forces that you can get going with the command points you have at your disposal. So that'll take us to the third aspect, and that is also represented by this organizational hierarchy, and that is command tracing. Effectively, you trace command down the structure. So I don't think it counts for army leaders, but an army leader can control his corps leader if they're within range of each other. I've kind of forgotten the specific rules of Lutzen, but let's just say Eugene to McDonald, that is 10 hexes. McDonald must be within 10 hexes of Eugene to be considered in command. Now, McDonald has divisions in his corps. Each of these divisions must be within 6 hexes of McDonald to be considered in command. Now, what does that mean? It means that the leaders must be within 6 hexes of McDonald's position on the map. And the same being true for McDonald and Eugene. Their physical leader counters must be within 10 hexes of each other. Now we've gotten down to the division level, and these divisions have constituent combat units. In order for those combat units to be in command of their division leader, they must be within 3 hexes of that leader's position. So the actual hex that the leader resides in must be within 3 hexes of every unit in his division for those units to be in command. It's the same basic rule for lines, columns, wings, brigades, whatever. That same structure and those same space relationships remain. Except light cavalry. They again are an exception. This one actually is going to be the same just because it's the cavalry leader I have, but the command span for light cavalry is actually the value of his cavalry modifier. That's the lower left corner here. So in this case, it is a 3, but if you had a cavalry leader with a 6, his command span would be 6. He could be within 6 hexes of any of his cavalry units, and they would still be in command. Now, there's a saying that the command is like rungs on a ladder. If you have battalions here for the 36th Division and they're within range of their division leader, they're in command. Now, if the division leader is out of range of his corps leader, that division leader is out of command, but the units are still in command. Now, if the corps is in the range of his divisions, but out of range of his army commander, the divisions are still in command, but the corps is not in command. So what does any of that mean? Why do we need to know any of that? Let's take a look at this setup I had here. So this is the 3rd Corps, which is a pretty big formation. All these battalions here represent the 8th Division. I didn't put the other divisions in place because I don't want all those counters clearing things up. But with command tracing, I can see that Napoleon is right here. Here's Marshal Ney. He's right, almost next to him. So that means Ney is in command. We see division leaders arrayed around. Here is the 8th Division's leader, right close to Ney. He's in command. But now look at how I've spread out all the battalions. Remember, they have to be within 3 hexes of the division leader to be considered in command. So at this point, with this poor layout, I can kind of get this group here and this artillery in command, but that battalion is out of command. The whole right-hand brigade here is out of command because they're not within range of that division leader. Now, let's suppose that this battalion were actually over here. 1, 2, 3, command tracing stops right there. But there is an exception that helps us kind of get out of this quandary, and it's called communicating battalions. Basically means that if all these battalions know what to do, they've been given orders because there's a division commander, and this guy's just out of range, well, he can kind of look to his right there and know what's supposed to be going on. So the battalions are able to communicate to each other as long as they maintain connection. That doesn't help me over here with this whole side of the field. This half of the division is basically helpless over here, out of command. So what does it mean to be out of command? Well, let's go back to our command points. Just with this little example, we have 2 command points at our disposal. Napoleon generates 1 and the marshal generates 1. So we want to use those command points to activate and basically allow units to move. So how do we do that? Well, we have two command points, so we spend a command point. There's actually the notion of activation. The high-level organizations can be activated by the army leader. Why is that important? We'll get to it. So first, Napoleon would say that the Third Corps is activated. And this little counter here, just an activation counter. So that means Ney has, you know, been given an order by Napoleon, although we shouldn't think of it quite that literally. It's more a function of the allocation of resources to get moving on the battlefield to achieve a plan. And this happens every turn. It's not like, you know, a dispatch being ridden over by a rider every 20 minutes. It's more like just an expression of will. So the corps is activated because it's close to Napoleon. What that means is if I spend a command point on that corps, as represented by this counter here, everything in command of that corps leader can be a part of the movement represented by that command point. So we know the 8th Division here is in command. Just so happens this 9th Division here, I don't have any counters for, but represented by that leader, he's in command. But I have another division right over there, way out of command, and another one over here, way out of command. So at this point, by using that command point, I could move two of the divisions of the Third Corps with one command point. Now, because I have another command point lying around, I'm going to go ahead and spend it and say that I'm going to move this 10th division over there. So I use my two command points to effectively move three divisions. But remember, this group over here is out of command of their division leader. So actually, I can only move effectively this brigade and some amount of the 9th Division, because I don't know what their command status of all the units is, but I would establish that. So I'd know how much of the 9th Division I can move, and then some amount of this 10th Division over here. Again, all the units that were in command span of their leader would be eligible to move. So that's how we spend, that's how we derive command points from our organizational structure and our leaders, and that's how we figure out the command status of individual formations and counters, and that's how we use the command points to enable parts of our army to move. That's kind of a long explanation, isn't it? But the concepts are really pretty simple. The mechanics aren't all that complicated. It does take more time to play, takes more attention to detail, but it does also regulate movement very tightly. I'm going to be hard-pressed to throw forces off on some crazy maneuver because once they're out of command, I'll have a hard time keeping them moving. I can, if I have enough command points at my disposal, I can keep spending individual command points to maneuver far-flung formations, but that's very inefficient. Just from looking at our core and that whole activation idea, the more of our forces we have within command of that core leader, the more of them we can move with the expenditure of a single command point. So that's our most optimum use of command points, getting the largest formation possible to move as many of their units as possible. So there's another pretty clear conclusion to draw from this. In the 5th edition, leaders are command. Let's look a little bit more at what that means. We said that tracing occurs between leaders, Napoleon to Ney, Ney to each of the divisions. Let's suppose that Ney is killed. We carelessly send him out. He's hit by a cannonball. He's out. Well, what happened to my command hierarchy? I've essentially broken a rung in the ladder. Now the battalions might be in command of their division leaders, but the division leaders have nobody above them. So I've lost the ability to activate that Third Corps. I've lost the ability to move three or four divisions with one command point. So keeping my structure intact is vital to the fifth edition. And because that's so important, there's actually a set of rules surrounding replacing leaders that fall. And they're kind of fall roughly into the categories of a step down, like a higher level leader would move down the hierarchy to fill in for a lower level leader, or a step up, where a lower level leader can take the place of a higher level. And individual titles will vary what is actually permitted sometimes. And it's often the case that once you lose a leader here, you lose his command point forever. So I might be able to step up this division leader to take over for the third corps, but all that means is he's able to keep the command tracing. That command point that came along with the marshal is gone forever. So a casualty is not the only way that we could possibly lose a leader. What if this battalion were to rout and retreat far away? We wouldn't want to send our divisional commander rushing after that guy to try to rally him, because that would disrupt our command, leave the rest of the division completely leaderless, and seriously hamper our ability to maneuver. So, in this case, the best thing to do is to use lower-level leaders, aides, and such, to chase after and try to rally units like that. Now, unfortunately, aides usually have much weaker qualities than a combat division leader. So it's not a great trade-off, but the command is worth more in this case. And it makes for an interesting choice. If you have a lot of battalions that are, you know, routing out of the plus grand disordering out of the game, now you're at risk of a morale level. So what's more important? You have to make a trade-off. Keeping the command or restoring your morale level. Those are some fun decisions you get to make with this kind of command structure. So there we've seen two very different approaches to the problem of command and control. Now, is the real lack of explicit controls in the premier side a glaring deficiency, or could it be seen as a liberation from the tyranny of designers? Is the increase in rule load and playtime in the 5th edition rules too much? Or does it make use of the historical conditions and really represent a reasonable constraint on play? I think each rule set is pretty clear in what they think of this. Premier rules say, be free. The other mechanics and systems in the game will really control your decisions when it comes to movement. Send a cavalry unit out, see them get cut off. Bad for you. Send an infantry division on some sort of a flanking march, see them waste their time and never have an impact on the game. Expose flanks, watch them get run down. So you will learn to control yourself just based on the interactions of the different mechanics of the game. The 5th edition, I think, is also pretty clear. We have these organizational hierarchies. We have these military formations. We know what these things were supposed to do. Let's let them do that. We have rules that are pretty reasonable that show us how to make use of those structures. And if we stick within them, we can really see some interesting things happen. Now, regardless of which approach you take or prefer, there's no question that any kind of risky play will be met with a beatdown from your opponent, so you'll learn, regardless of whether you use explicit or implicit controls. So which is better? You know, you will pick based on your own preferences. And of course, read the rules for all the pesky details. I'm not going to read rules to you. We're just trying to sum up the concepts and some of the mechanics. So there are more details to be found. Go ahead and seek those out.